Hi, everyone. My name is Adrian Lovejoy. I'm the Assistant Director of Athletics here at Colby. Thank you all for coming tonight, and those of you live streaming at home, we have a really exciting speaker with us this evening. I am going to introduce a football athlete of ours, Patrick Day, who will let us know who we're going to listen to tonight.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for taking the time to come out to speak today. I'm going to introduce someone I just met about 5 minutes ago. Great dude. Love him already. This is Travis Mills, retired U.S. Army Staff Sergeant of the 82nd Airborne, who is the CEO of the Travis Mills Foundation, which is a small business owner, and he's a New York Times bestselling author. Find his book out on and around. I'm pretty sure the book is Tough As They Come. Ordered it today. Great book. Further ado, Travis Mills.
Thank you, Patrick. Appreciate it. All right, guys. It's harder with a small crowd, to be honest with you, because I got to make sure everybody likes my jokes. So I always start off by telling everybody I'm a little bit nervous to be here today, but truly right now I am now in front of you. And I always just hope I don't bomb it, you know, because like last time what happened and everything, you know. All right, you guys got me. All right, cool. Yeah, there it is. All right, so check it out. No, I'm excited to be here today. I like to start my presentation off kind of the same way every time, with the same opening lines, because I think it helps set the tone for how today is supposed to go. So right up front, the first thing about me that you need to know is, number one, I'm awesome, okay? And number two, I'm humble, in that order. So I'm awesome, then I'm humble. Now, we should also be friends on a personal level. So I'm gonna tell you a secret about myself that you guys can take home, tell your families and your friends that now you and I are best friends. Here's my big secret that I never tell anybody else, but only you guys. I don't wash my hands after I use the bathroom. I don't see the point in it, so I just wash my hand. You see what I know, it's crazy. It doesn't even hurt. You thought it would, but it don't. I like to tell jokes. I think it helps disarm the situation. You know what I'm saying? Knee slapper, like if you got them. I don't, but if you do, like, go for it. All right, now, ladies and gentlemen, check it out. On the screen right now behind me, you will see my wonderful wife, Kelsey, and everything in my life at this point is going fantastic, right? Just had a baby, just bought a house, just got promoted. And I honestly, no offense to anybody in the room that's married and have a spouse, like, I have the best spouse in the world. And here's how I know that, right? My daughter was born, my wife went into labor like 14 hours or something. I fell asleep for most of it, right? But I woke up for the important parts. I'll be honest, I woke up and my daughter was born. And we thought, what do we name this sweet little angel? We thought Madison or Avery. And my wife from the hospital bed looked up at me with a heavy sigh and was like, we have to name her Chloe Lynn, don't we? And I was like, we don't have to. What makes you even think that? And she looked at me and she's like, well, of course we have to, because you're an idiot and you already have your ex-girlfriend's name tattooed on your arm, which, I mean, so we named her Chloe Lynn after my ex-girlfriend. And that's not true, but I'm loving that you guys are getting my jokes. No, my ex-girlfriend's a terrible person. We're going to talk about her later, actually. She's awful. So anyways, like I said, everything in my life... Yes, I need the hype, lady. You're killing it for me. I appreciate you. So here's the thing. Everything in my life is going absolutely fantastic in this picture. Well, I'm not going to start it there. We're going to back it up a little bit. All right? Top left of your screen, you will see my mom and dad's favorite day in their whole entire lives. Straight up. That's April 14th, 1987, when their favorite child was born. Me. Okay, let me tell you what happened, because you guys are probably wondering, how am I the favorite? Well, they had my sister, right, first, and the doctor said, it's a girl. My mom, she was like, crap. And my dad yelled, not what we wanted, you know. So they went back to the drawing board, right, and then they had me. And when I was born and the doctor showed my parents, you know, me, they both cried perfection at the same time. The doctors put orange stuff on my forehead, actually, and held me to the ceiling as they played the Circle of Life. Yeah, no, it was beautiful. And then my parents got a little cocky on their winning streak, right? So they thought they could duplicate me. And they had my brother, and they almost named him Daisy. Yeah, no, for like whoops-a-daisy, that didn't go as planned. I know, right? It's crazy. I'm from a small town in Michigan. I'm not from Maine. A lot of people think I'm from here. I'm not. I'm from Michigan, right? And I grew up playing high school sports. Well, first I played football, basketball, I did some powerlifting, you probably noticed, and I did some track. I have a junior high shot put record still, so whatever, just so you guys should know. And then I went to high school sports, and I played football and basketball and baseball as a varsity captain of the teams, and I was a fullback and a linebacker. And like a lot of you in this room, you know, like for instance you know, we've met before. I know that we met. You know, we have so much in common. We're both astute businessmen, obviously, very good looking. And we both peaked in high school. And you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Yeah, the best days are behind us, and everybody knows that. But check this out. Look how awesome I was. I was number 5, and I was a linebacker. I'm making tackles. Mills, you know what I'm saying? Glory days. You get it. So, I'm like, Coach, that's amazing. I'll tell you tomorrow. So here I am at 18, living 2.5 hours away from my mom and dad's house where I grew up, right, in my apartment. I give my girlfriend back home a call and tell her the awesome news. And she's like, oh, that's cool, but I thought you were going to move home for me. That's what she said to me. And I was like, why would I do that? Yeah, and then I moved home, and then 2 weeks later, I met her boyfriend, Colin. I know, by accident, trust me, it wasn't on purpose. So I joined the military because of that. And I look back at my life, I'm like, man, how did this happen? How did I lose my arms and legs? It's her fault. I don't hold a grudge, though. I don't want you guys to think I hold a grudge, right? But if she fell down a well, you know, like, oh, well, you know what I'm saying? Whatever. So anyway, I found out, no, I know we're sitting in a college, but I just got to be honest, true to myself here. And I went to the recruiting station, and I walked into the Marines and the Army's recruiting stations, and I went to the Marines first, and I walked in this big barrel-headed, like bald-headed, you know, or barrel-chested, bald-headed, whatever. Guy stands up, and he's like, you want to be a Marine? Like, real intense, and I was like, I don't know, tell me about it, bro. And he's like, I'll put you in a career field. And I was like, man, that sounds cool. What's that even mean? He said, well, if you pick this job, you might not get it. So I'll put you in this other job. And I was like, what? And he kept saying career field, like I was going to understand what he's talking about. So I was like, okay. I went to the Army's office. I walked in, and the guy's like, you want to join the Army? I said, I don't know. Tell me about it. He said, I'll give you a $24,000 signing bonus. And I went, that sounds pretty good. So I said, hold that thought, because I'm a dummy. Obviously, you guys know that about me already. So I went back across the hall and asked the Marine, what's your signing bonus? He stands up again. He's like, honor, duty, respect. And I was like, awesome. That's cool. Like, I'm talking cash money, bro. And he's like, there's no money here. And I was like, what idiot would join that? And they're called Marines. Man, they are dumb. I'll tell you what. Don't worry, though. They don't get my jokes. So I joined the Army. $24,000. Ladies and gentlemen, do you know what that money is today? Me neither. Not a clue. But whatever. I know. Yeah. No, it's. You'll find out where it's actually. I'm going to tell you next. So anyways, I went to the Army, went through basic training, then airborne school, learned how to jump out of airplanes. It's not as hard as you think. You literally just fall out. Gravity. And then I went to Fort Bragg, home of the 82nd Airborne Division. And when I got there, I got to deploy for 15 months to Afghanistan. And while I was over there, I was lifting weights. I was going on missions every day, having a good time. I had a medic named Josh Buck. He's in the third picture over here. And Josh Buck was a great friend of mine. He was from Texas. He used to rope and ride, and he like was married. His daughter was being born. He was going to go home for his daughter to be born in late September. So, you know, I knew everything about this guy, I thought. And he goes home, and I get a MySpace friend request, which a lot of you don't know what that is. It's Facebook before Facebook. So I get a MySpace friend request. This picture pops up, and I'm like, I don't know her. That's a dating site for sure. That's just an ad. So I go hit decline, but then I realize that's the same last name as my medic. Yeah. And like, he didn't tell me anything about any other family members that, you know, I figured he would have told me about. So I did a little super sleuth, you know, Sherlock Holmes style research on my own. And I found out that that's his little sister. And she's 18 and in college, and she thinks I'm cute. And he never told me about her. So like, now I got a decision to make, right? I either hit accept and upset him, or hit decline and respect his friendship. And there's like one thing in life I'm really good at, and say antagonizing people. Like, I'll give you for instance, like when I got injured, I asked my mom, I said, Mom, why'd this happen? And she was like, well, you know, karma. So, I know, right? No, I'm kidding. She didn't say that. But so anyways, I hit accept, and me and this lovely young lady start chit-chatting. And I'm 20 in Afghanistan, she's 18, right? In college in Texas, and we're thinking like, we should probably hang out. So we try to go over, like, should we go to Michigan? Should we go to Texas? Where should we go? And we landed on, let's go to Mexico. You know, it makes sense. So I flew into Mexico, never met her. I flew into Dallas to pick her up, you know, and her dad answers the door. And here I am at 6'3", 275. I was lifting some weights at the time. And he's looking up at me, his knees are trembling. He's like, please don't hurt me, sir, you know? And like, I gave him a noogie. I'm like, I'm not gonna hurt you, buddy, you know? And then he's like, thank you, sir. And I said, now get out of here. And I smacked him on the butt. You know, and like, in a way he went. And that never happened. But good news, he did not shoot me. And that's what matters. He's in the back of the room. Probably can't see him. He goes around with me all the time. My father-in-law, my right-hand man. Because I don't have one. So anyways, me and Kelsey, right? I meet her up in Dallas for the first time ever. The next day we fly out to Mexico for a week. It's going great. Fly back to Michigan for a week. It went awesome. She goes back to Dallas. I got to go back to Afghanistan. So we get held up, or I get held up in Atlanta for the night. So I give her a phone call. Hey, I'm in Atlanta. Do you want to fly back? She says, yes. She flies back to Atlanta from Dallas for the night. You guys might see now where $24,000 actually went. And the next morning, saying our goodbyes, right? She had these crocodile tears just like streaming down her face with heavy sobs and real ugly cry. You don't want to look at, but you have to because you're a gentleman. And she's like, and then in between those, she's like, I love you. And I'm like, I love you too. Because that's what you say in the situation. You know, and then she's like, I want to marry you. And I threw it back at her, right? I was like, I'm going overseas 3 months. I'm going to lose my girlfriend I met 2 weeks ago. So let me just say this, you know, I want to marry you too. And then she was like, all of a sudden, tears just gone, dried up. Matter of fact, in Atlanta airport, as I recall, there was 3 birds inside there chirping the most beautiful song you've ever heard. And then a double rainbow across the sky. And then a unicorn actually ran out of the terminal. No, it was majestic. So anyways, I strut my stuff, right? I'm feeling pretty good about the conversation I just had because my girlfriend is no longer crying and she's super happy and I'll see her again in like 3 months. So I get on my airplane, I fly back to Afghanistan, she goes back to Dallas. 24 hours later, I give her a phone call, I'm like, hey, what's going on? And she's like, guess what? And I'm like, I don't know, I've been on a plane, what's going on, like what? And she tells me, the wedding's planned. And I was like, oh no, well, I didn't see that coming, you know? So anyways, we get married, right? We had a wedding, got a dog, got an apartment for Bragg. And ladies and gentlemen, I take every chance I get to brag about my dog. He's got a unique name though, okay? So see if you can keep up. It's a yellow lab, his name is Buddy. I know, that's unheard of, I get it. It's unique. And everybody's like, you want a service dog? And I'm like, I don't want a service dog. And they're like, yeah, but like, why not? I'm like, because I have a dog. And they're like, yeah, but Travis, don't you like want a dog that listens? And that's offensive, right? I'm like, he listens, watch this. And I show my dog's tricks off. I'm like, hey, buddy, sit when you want, you know? And that dog eventually, he'll sit down. It's crazy. He'll go walking off somewhere. I'm calling him back. I'm like, come over here. Like, when you're done over there or something, you know? Stop barking when you feel like it. You know, it's just, he's great. I put an invisible fence in, though, because he kept walking off and not really listening to me. And now he has to. And when I have a bad day, people are like, what do you do to relieve stress, you know? Like, what's your thing? And I'm like, I throw the ball over the fence, you know. I'm kidding, I can't throw, you know what I'm saying? I actually, I got a pitching machine, it does the same thing. So, we get the apartment, we get the dog, I go back overseas for a year. A lot more firefights, a lot more action. Threw some grenades, I took 4 showers in 1 year. Not by choice, actually, believe it or not. Just how we were living. And then, you know, we're coming back home and I gave my wife a call, you know, I can't remember what day it was, gave her a call. I was like, hey, what's going on? And she's like, guess what? You know, first thing she said, and automatically, like, red flags. I'm like, I got married last time. Oh, no. Like, which I love being married, but I'm just saying, like, what, you know? And she said, I bought a house today. And I said, oh, that's awesome. But how did you buy a house today? Like, you're in college. You have literally no income right now. And then she's like, well, do you remember that power of attorney that you signed? Which actually grants anybody access to do anything in your name while you're away or whatever. So she had my power of attorney to do whatever I wanted. And I said, yeah, like for banking. She goes, no, for everything. You bought a house today. So I bought a house. I came back, and 4 months after that, we found out we were going to have a baby, which is very exciting. And my daughter was born, you know, in late September of 2011. And everything was going my way. That picture you guys saw first, just bought my house, just promoted, had my daughter. Everything was going great. And then the big army said, hey, Travis, you know, you've had over 2 years combat experience. You should go to Fort Hood. We got orders for you to Fort Hood. We're setting up a new brigade. You can sit this deployment out. And I just couldn't do that. I said, no, my guys are going overseas. I got to go. It's just like a sports team, right? Like it's your brotherhood or sisterhood, depending on what sport you're in. And for me, it was just like, they come from all across this nation. They serve under me. They believe in me. And I have to go overseas with them. And my wife understood it. So I canceled my orders to deploy. I went overseas for my third time in February of 2012. And first day in the country was a huge firefight. The second day was another massive firefight. And third day was the same. We were in a very high volume combat zone. And about a month and a half in, we got a phone call from a village elder, which is pretty normal. And he asked us for some help in the village. We said, yeah, no problem. So on April 10th, we went on patrol like normal, right? We strapped our gear on. We were talking about where we're going to go out. We always had a minesweeper in front of us, a guy with a minesweeper going back and forth. He swept the ground not once but twice, marked it safe. We came to a short halt, and I took my backpack off, and I set my backpack on the ground. And under my backpack actually was a bomb. And the bomb went off, and it automatically tore off my right arm and right leg. They actually never found those pieces of me. They threw me to the left side of my face, and when I rolled over on my back, I saw my right side was completely gone, right? And my left side was still there, but my left arm was blown out at the wrist really bad, and my left leg was snapped to the bone. So if you can imagine your left ankle bone touching your left thigh. So I hit the ground, roll over, I see all this, and immediately, like instantly, my medic's on me, and my platoon sergeant's on me. They're putting tourniquets on me. And I tell them, hey guys, don't worry about it. You're not going to save me. Like, go save my guys. They had two other guys yelling for the medic. And it wasn't that I was suicidal. It was just in my line of work, I saw a lot of guys die for what I thought was a lot less injury. So I thought, don't waste your time. It's just not going to happen. And they ignored me, and they put tourniquets on. And they put tourniquets on me within 30 seconds or 20 seconds. They had tourniquets on both limbs. And they were, you know, as they're working on me, only thing in my head is the movie Saving Private Ryan, as weird as that might sound. Because in that movie, there is a medic that gets shot in the stomach. He finds out he's going to die, and he always cries, and then he cries out for his mom. He begs not to die, but ultimately he dies. And I always told myself, whatever situation I find myself in, I am never going to be that guy. So I stayed calm. I was always first in a firefight, last out. I exuded confidence, and I never showed fear. That's how I led. So instead of freaking out, right, I calmly reached out to my trucker mic on my chest. I radioed my lieutenant. I said, hey, Six, this is Four. I got guys injured. I need your medic with mine. So Lieutenant Lewis sent over Doc Voice. Doc Voice worked on the other two guys. Then they worked on me. They got me on a helicopter within 10 minutes of that and took me to the hospital. And they offloaded me at the hospital. And as they were pushing me down the hallway, I kept seeing the lights go by in the hallway of a hospital as I was laying on the gurney. And I kept trying to sit up. And the nurse kept pushing me down. And the third time she pushed me down, I yelled at her, quit touching me, I'm fine, leave me alone, I gotta get back to my guys. And I said, I just got my feet back underneath me, I'll be fine. And the nurse looked at me and said, Sergeant Mills, I don't know how you're still awake right now, but you need to go to sleep. And she pushed fluids into me to knock me out. And the last thing I said, I looked at that nurse and I said, my little girl, am I ever gonna see her again? Because Chloe was only 6 months old at that time. So they knocked me out. And then 9 doctors and 7 nurses worked on me for 14 hours straight. 2 nurses, just like you see on TV, took turns pumping air in and out of my lungs for 9 hours. I was given over 400 units of blood, which is actually the most blood ever given to anybody in Afghanistan at that time. And they ran out of blood in the blood bank for A positive and universal blood. So there was nurses pulling it right from their veins and putting it right into me. There was people that were rushing to the hospital to donate their blood to make sure that I got enough. So this went on for 14 hours to keep me stable but critical. While this is all happening, I'm, you know, sitting there getting worked on. my brother-in-law, Josh, gets the phone call. He's in Afghanistan in a different spot. He gets a phone call about what happened to me, and he has to fly into Kandahar. Because when you're in the military, you fill out paperwork before you deploy. In the Army, it's called a blue book. And it's the most morbid thing you're probably going to ever have to do. You got to fill out paperwork on your funeral, right? So I'm going to be buried here. I want to have this music played. I want to have this in my coffin. Like in my coffin, when I was buried, I wanted my wedding ring and a picture of me and Kelsey and Chloe, right? There was, you know, that kind of like stuff you had to plan out. And the last thing was, who escorts your body home, if anybody? So on my paperwork, I was escorting Josh home. And Josh was escorting me home. Now I was going to escort him if anything happened. So he gets a phone call to come in because they think I'm still going to die. And they got me stable but critical. At the end of the day, I was a triple amputee. My left leg, my right leg, and my right arm were gone. 2 days after that, they flew me to Bagram, Afghanistan. And on April 12th, they took me in for a clean out, and they checked out my wounds, my injuries, and they realized the skin on my wrist and my hand had died. So they had to cut it off. So they cut my hand off, and now I'm a quadruple amputee. 2 days after that, they flew me and Josh to Landstuhl, Germany. And in Germany, they woke me up from my medical sedation for the very first time. And as I came to, the only person in the room when I woke up was my brother-in-law, Josh. And when I saw him, the first thing out of my mouth was, "My soldiers, how are my soldiers?" It's always mission first. And he tells me, you know, "Ryan's here with us, and Brandon's back in Kandahar. You took most of the blast. They're going to be okay." I said, "All right." And then I looked at Josh and I said, "Am I paralyzed?" And Josh said, "No." And I looked at him, you know, and I shook my head a little bit. I said, "Josh, I can't feel my fingers and toes. You can tell me the truth. Like, am I paralyzed?" And he said, "Man, you're not paralyzed, but you don't have them anymore." He just broke it to me straight. Didn't want to lie and sugarcoat it. Just let me know. And I said, "Oh." And for 3 hours, ladies and gentlemen, I ignored everybody. The doctors had questions. The nurse had questions. Right? Josh had questions. And as they were trying to talk to me, I look off in the other direction because I have my own questions, right? Am I a bad person? Does God hate me? What did I do wrong in life to deserve this? How can I be a husband and a father? And the biggest question I had was, why did I just die? Like, how is this better? Well, then after 3 hours, Josh chimes in. He's like, "Look, man, I'm not even going to pretend like I know what you're going through, because I don't. But you got to call your wife and your parents." And I agreed. I said, "Okay, cool." So I called my wife, and when she answered, the only thing I said to her was, "Hey, what's up? I'm fine. Love you. Bye." Like, that's it. I didn't want to have a conversation with her. When my parents were on the phone, I talked to them for a little bit about the same conversation. And before I hung up, my mom said, "Hey, Travis, happy birthday." Because it was my 25th birthday that day that I woke up. 3 days after that, I arrived at Walter Reed. And as they got me out of the truck and pushed me towards the hospital, here comes my wife, Kelsey, running to see me. And before she gets to me, one of the doctors stops her and says, "Mrs. Mills, Travis's right leg is ripped open. His sutures have split. We have to cut 2 inches off his right leg or he will bleed out and die. And we need you to sign this medical form now because you are now in charge of his medical care. So we need you to sign this so we can do this procedure." So Kelsey took the clipboard and looked at me, right? Looked at the clipboard, looked at the doctors, looked at me again, said, "You know what? I didn't want to deal with this anyway. He can bleed out. It's totally cool." She gave it back and walked away. Nah, she didn't, but thanks for believing it. So she signed it. And the next day on the 18th, my wife came in, and here she is, right? I have my wonderful wife who is 23 now with a six-month-old on her hip, and she walks in, and I tell her, "Look, you don't have to do this. Like, I don't want this to be the life for you. I have to have someone literally feed me, help me dress myself. And this is not something I would choose for you, so you can take Chloe and you can go. Like, you can live a better life, and financially, whatever I can do, I will take care of and support you. But I don't think that we should, you know, that you should have to do this." You know, she looked at me, and she thought about it, and she goes, "You know, I have been wondering what the right answer is." And she goes, I think I'm going to stay, though, because I really want handicapped parking. So we're, like, going to try this out." Now, she was actually offended. I even told her she can go. And she's like, "That's not how this works. We'll get through this together." So, ladies and gentlemen, I get the opportunity to speak locally, right, because I live over in Manchester outside of Augusta, and abroad, all across this nation. These are the four things that I think got me better. And this is the only PowerPoint slide. It's going to look like a PowerPoint, like your lectures you guys sometimes have here in college. But so I talk about motivation, right, goal setting, healthcare technology, like how this stuff all works, right, because that's pretty cool. You think that would hurt, but it don't. The first time it fell off, though, I'll be honest, very painful. And then after that, life's all about perspective, right? So Check it out. Motivation. I got my motivation because my wife said she's going to stay by my side. I gave her the out. I said, you can go. Like, and I wanted her to go. Deep down, I said, this is not life I would choose for you. But she says she's going to stay. And then my daughter comes in my room, six-month-old Chloe. And I think she's going to be so afraid of me. Because I went from 250 pounds on that deployment to 140 in those 7 days. I lost 110 pounds. I had a PICC line come out of my neck. I had sticky things all over my chest. You know, stuff in my nose, wound vac machines in my legs. I mean, it was a pretty scary sight, I thought. And she lays on my chest, and she starts to laugh and giggle and play. And I was just like, how is this kid not afraid of me? And then it dawns on me, oh, because I look like every single toy she's ever been given. Yeah, like short arms, right? Short legs, fuzzy chest. That's not a sweater, fuzzy chest. But for these two, I'm going to be able to get better because I look like a teddy bear, right? And for these two, it's worth going forward. And then I thought, well, how am I going to do it? Well, luckily, we all need a mentor in life or someone to look up to or someone to explain some stuff to us. And I had this guy walk in, this robot. And he walks in with his fake arms and fake legs, and he goes, hey, man, welcome to the club. And I looked at him and said, I don't want to be in your club. He said, kind of late now, don't you think? I goes, oh, you got me there. And he explained. He said, I'm Todd Nicely. I'm a retired Marine corporal. I'm the second ever quadruple amputee. Unfortunately, you're the fourth. But I saw your story, and I wanted to come make sure that you knew nothing you did is the result of what happened. You're not a bad person, and you're going to be able to do everything you want to do. Walk, drive, feed yourself. Everything that you're thinking you can't do, you're going to be able to do it. And after that meeting that day, I had two thoughts run through my head, right? Number one, I'm not alone in this. Someone else has been through this. And number two, it's probably super easy to get better because he's a Marine. And I mean, he did it, you know? Like, yeah, because they're so dumb. Exactly. You guys got it. So anyways, after I was able to, you know, get my motivation levels right, I had to start setting some goals, right? And the first goal that I set was, you know what? I need to be able to, you know, use a hand again, feed myself and all that. So 5 weeks into my recovery, I put my arm on for the very first time. I learned how to open it, close it, and rotate it. And I went to the Fisher House after I got to work out with it, and I fed myself for the very first time. I dipped it into this lasagna. I picked it up. I said, this looks good. Took a massive bite of it. I chewed it up and swallowed it, and the camera cut out. And the next thing I said was, can someone please give me some milk? It's so hot. It's burning my insides. I should have waited. We've all been there, right? I know. But I was able to feed myself and dress myself and, you know, not to be weird about it, but use the restroom by myself again at 5 weeks. And then I decided, you know what? I probably should start walking again. You know, I've been in this wheelchair, in this bed long enough. Like, it's time to start walking. So 7 weeks and 4 days into my recovery, I took my very first steps around the Military Advanced Training Center, which is just an acronym. You know, they call it the MATSE. It's just the gym. And they said, you're probably going to walk one lap today. And it's a small track, like 27 laps makes a mile. And I said, no, I'm going to walk three today. So I strap my legs on. I start to walk around. And as I'm going around, you know, I make the first lap. And they're like, okay, you can sit down. I said, no, I got to go three just to prove to myself I can do it. And my legs were like, they felt like they were in cement. And my legs were pulsating real bad from the blood pooling in the bottom of my legs. But I did. I walked three laps that day. And I was able to start walking just shy of 2 months. All right. So those are two short-term goals. And the other short-term goal that I had, on my birthday, I didn't want to call my wife. I didn't want to call my parents, but I told my brother-in-law, Josh, I said, you got to call my unit, Josh. I got to talk to them. Find their number. So Josh called my unit, and when they answered the phone, I started to talk to them on the phone saying, hey, guys, thanks so much for all you did. Like, I'm fine. Don't worry about me anymore. They got to be mission-dependent or mission-focused, right? They can't depend on me to be there anymore, but they can still keep in the fight and not worry about me. So I told them, hey, guys, thanks for all you did. And I made them a promise. I said, I will be there when you get home from Afghanistan. I'll be there, plain side, on my legs, with my arm, to give you a big hug and a salute and welcome you back home. And at this point, and this is 4 days after my injury, but I worked out three hours. I got approved to take my legs home. I drove 6.5 hours from Walter Reed in Bethesda, Maryland, to my house in North Carolina, and I made it just in time to see my guys get home. The top left picture is actually a documentary reenactment, but the bottom right is me hugging Dan Bateson that night, saying, hey, man, I appreciate it. You saved my life, and welcome home. So those are some of my short-term goals, right? We all have short-term and long-term goals, or we should. And my long-term goals, when I met Todd Nicely, he came in the next day with four firemen from New York City. And he said, hey, Travis, we're part of the Tunnel to Towers 5K. We put it on every year in New York City. It's in remembrance of the first responders, and we'd love to have you be a part of it. And I said, yeah, I can't wait to walk it. And they're like, well, you know, if you can't, we'll push you because, you know, you probably won't be ready to walk it. But either way, we want you to come. I said, yeah, I'll be there. So I had my legs, my tall legs I'm wearing today, I had them for 1 week. And I strapped my legs on, and I started to walk the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel in this 5K course in New York City. And I thought, let me just see how far I can get, right? So I get my legs on, I start walking, and all of a sudden my back's starting to hurt a little bit. My right leg's rubbing raw, like if you have new shoes, it gets your blister on your heel. It was doing that inside of my thigh. And I was drenched in sweat. And I was going through the tunnel, I thought, when I come out of the tunnel, I'm gonna sit down. But when I came out of the tunnel, there was 343 firemen, which you guys just saw, with the banners around their neck to represent the lives lost on 9/11, of the first responders. And I thought, if those brave men and women could finish out, you know, their lives by dying in the rubble and the ruin and perishing all that commotion, I should be able to finish this last mile. So instead of sitting down when I came out of the tunnel for the last mile, I finished it off, I walked it. And when I got done, my right leg was bleeding, my back was killing me, and it looked like I just got out of the pool. I was drenched in sweat. But I got invited up on stage, and there was a band playing. You guys ever heard of Lieutenant Dan Band? You guys know who Gary Sinise is, right? No big deal. I'm like personal friends with him now, so I could call him right now on my phone. No, I could. No, don't treat me any different, but he's famous and I know him, so whatever. But I get up on stage, and I got my left hand, has a crutch, and the crowd's going wild, and I'm like waving at him, and like feels like 20,000 people just going wild. And they're all cheering for me. And I'm like, hey, be my friend. And as I'm walking, the cord's on the stage. I don't see him. And my toe catches it. And I go right down. So the whole crowd goes from, yeah, to, oh. It's kind of embarrassing. But luckily, there was a bodyguard there because he was on the stage and in charge of it. 6'7", just knight in shining armor, right? Picks me up under my armpits like a rag doll, honestly. And like, whoop, like up I go. Crowd goes wild. This man named Brian. Brian has no idea how my legs work. He sets me down abruptly. My legs fold in again. Hit the deck. The whole crowd, oh. But don't worry though. Brian, luckily, he's a great guy. Very determined man. Picks me up again. He sets me down gently. My wife's like, don't drop him, don't drop him. I get my crutch set, get my legs set. Brian's like, are you good? I look back at Brian, and I'm like, I'm good, Brian. He steps back, crowd goes wild. He steps in and goes, Travis, hey man, we did it. Smacks me on the back. Drops me. Embarrassing. The whole crowd started yelling mercy. They threw cabbages at him, actually. It was crazy. I stood up and I yelled freedom, you know. It's a real Braveheart moment if you ask me. So anyways, so I walked 5K. On top of that, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know, since we are in Waterville area, Oakland, I'm sure where we're considered, be very careful because, yes, I drive. And I'm a terrible, I'm like one of the worst drivers you've ever met. And I don't say that lightly. I tell you that because when I got the adaptations on my vehicles and all that stuff, I had to retake my driver's test, and it cost me $450, which sounds like highway robbery. But let me tell you what happened. $50, I failed. $400, I passed. You know what I'm saying? Money buys everything. Don't forget that, kid. So here's the no. So I have two vehicles, right? I have two vehicles that I drive. I have my van, which is hooked up with all these hand controls. Really cool, the technology in it. The little blue button by the New Balance logo on my door, on my shoe there, is everything. I hit that with my left leg, it beeps, and the first beep is left turn. I hold it for two beeps is right turn, three is a horn, four is a dimmer switch, you know, five is windshield wipers, six and seven are windows, and eight is cruise control, that one button. And then the gray box right here by my right shoulder, that's my throttle. So believe it or not, it looks like a joystick, like a, and I pull back like this, and I'm 0 to 60 in like 18 seconds. It's a minivan, so it's like 18 seconds, but still. And I push forward, that's my brake. But if you guys take my van for a joyride, right here, if you take my van out here, but yeah, don't push that too hard because it'll barrel roll because it's emergency brake, kicks right in. So it's a flaw. Don't tell them I said that, but it's a flaw in the, whatever. Just be careful. And then I have a truck, right? And the dumbest thing ever, they say pride comes before the fall. Mine was different. I went to the truck, like the dealer, and I was looking for these 250s, and I went to get inside this one, and my leg wasn't tall enough. My butt missed the seat, and I fell over. And the guy was like, you're not gonna buy that one, I guess. And I said, I'll take that one. So I bought a truck and I lifted it up and put bigger tires on it, like I have calf muscles to jump in it. And but it's got a tuner and it rips. But anyway, so I get pulled over all the time, to be honest with you. All I do is say my leg got stuck, I couldn't feel it, and let me go. Yeah. But anyway, Craig, you show the video. Look, check this out. I'm just racing through a cornfield, guys. I'm not supposed to be in this cornfield, they don't care. No, so the worst part I can tell you guys is I do drive, and I don't even drive this truck anymore. That one had my logo on it, so people knew I was coming. You guys won't see me coming. Good luck. So, on top of that, ladies and gentlemen, at Walter Reed, Kelsey and I were blessed with a lot of nonprofits out there doing a lot of good things. And we thought we should be able to give back, you know? So we started the Travis Mills Foundation. And the reason we started it was I thought we should at least be able to send care packages overseas to my buddies and their new units that they're in when they're overseas. And we sent cool things, right? These care packages weren't like your socks and your baby powder and all that stuff. No, we sent Orbit gum, right? Pepper Jack cheese, because this is my favorite, and I thought they would enjoy it. Pepper beef jerky, because teriyaki's gross. But anyways, we sent care packages for $5,000 of a donation from Kelsey and I. And then while we were at Walter Reed, I started going on all these cool trips, right? I learned how to go snowboarding. I can monoski, which not really. I just tumbled down the mountain, but let's not get in the weeds of that. Kayaking, canoeing, all that stuff. And then I went out and did downhill mountain biking, which is like this picture right here. So imagine, if you will, you go to Mount Crested Butte in Colorado. They take you up 9,000 feet on this mountain. And then while you're up there, they put you in this four-wheel bike. And you're like, oh, this is awesome. What do I do? Then they cinch you down to the seat with a strap. So you can't get out. And you're like, oh, this is kind of scary. What do I do? And then they take your hands and they duct tape them to your prosthetic hands to the handlebars. So you really can't get out. And you're like, what do I do? And they put a helmet on your head and they just say, don't die. And I'm like, what? And they push you down a mountain. I went 9 times. It was great, honestly. But the truth is, like, when I went on these trips, I was injured to the point where I needed to take a non-medical assistant with me. Because I still, to this day, need help putting my arms and legs on the right way. It's like the worst 5 minutes of my day, but at least I have someone to help me do it, which is usually Craig in the back, my father-in-law. But my wife and I went on these trips together because I needed her there. And I thought, well, I'm only doing this because, you know, it's for my family, things I can do adaptively with my family. So we thought, let's expand our idea for the Travis Mills Foundation. Some of you might already know what we do. Some of you maybe never even heard of it. I get it. But we went ahead and brought some families out to Maine because we thought we could recreate the trips that I went on, but for the family as a whole. And we got these people that came up. You got Josh Wetzel in the orange shirt and from Auburn, Alabama. And then you got Andrew Smith from Chattanooga, Tennessee, both double leg amputees. And then you got myself, my buddy Taylor. He's a quadruple amputee. He's actually from Iowa. He's the fifth and so far final. We hope it stays that way. And then you got a guy that showed up with one leg missing and was like knocking on the door. He's like, hey, can I come in? And we're like, no. I know. And he's like, I'm missing a leg though. And we're like, no one cares about your paper cut, bro. Like, go home. No, he's from Ohio. His name's Drew. And since I'm from Michigan, it's a rivalry football thing. I don't respect him. But no, he's a great guy. So we brought them and their families out, and we decided to just try this out. It went so well that we bought a facility. It was Elizabeth Arden's old estate, which she built in 1929. It was in really bad disrepair, to be honest with you. But we bought it. We fixed it up over 2 years and like $2.5-3 million. And we officially opened in 2017. And our main goal is to bring out families, 8 families per week, that have been through the same kind of injuries like me, physical injuries, paralyzation, amputations, spinal cord injuries, anything that falls under that from service, not just combat, but service. And we show them how to do things adaptively. So the first year in 2017, we did 89 families. The second year, we did 135. And the third year, we did over 200. During COVID, we actually helped more families virtually and in person than we ever had before. And we're doing really great things to the point where we expanded our programs. And this is important for everybody in the room because maybe you don't know someone that looks like me due to service. But if you have anybody in your family that's going through post-traumatic stress from either like first responder, firefighter, police officer, EMT, or service, they can come to our post-traumatic stress program, which is we run 10 weeks out of the year. It's really great. It's called the Warrior Path Program. We partner with somebody else, and there's a big grant that goes into it. But if you guys want to find out more, you know, visit TravisMillsFoundation.org. I don't take a dime of it. It's not about paying me. This is about giving back to the families and showing them to not live life on the sidelines, to always be active in their community, in their society, and give them the option to keep pushing forward. And, you know, this is my new way of serving because, honestly, people out there believe in me and they help me do it. So if you guys want to find out more, come volunteer. Love to have you. There's internships actually available if you're occupational therapy or recreational therapy or physical therapy student. And like I said, you can visit TravisMillsFoundation.org for all that information. Now, let's check it out. We should be on healthcare technologies. And I'll be honest with you, right here in the front row in the red pants, you've been checking my legs out all day. That's all I can give you, okay, because I'm married. But that's it. But people wonder how they work. So how my legs work, you get the short legs and the white shorts. Then you get the taller legs with the green shoelaces. And the green shoelaces, those legs don't do anything special. They don't bend. They just make you taller so you fall faster and hit harder. But after those, you get the ones I'm wearing now. And the ones I'm wearing now are called X3s, and they are awesome. They have 4 distinct functions with them, right? So they're a little microprocessor. So every time I move, internally, they make over 300 adjustments per second to keep me as upright as possible. On top of that, like I charge them like once every 5 days because they're battery powered. On top of that, my legs are Bluetooth. So when I drive my truck, I have a little remote in my truck and it locks my leg from walk mode to drive mode. So if you guys imagine my hand is my foot, my elbow is my knee in this situation, right? I go walk mode and all of a sudden I hit the drive mode remote, boom, 25 degree angle. It locks out and I drive like everybody else with my right foot. They have, they're waterproof. So that works in the rain really good. But here's the problem, right? I'm on my boat, I've had 115 margaritas, whatever. I know, and I fall in the water. Guess what? Uh-oh, that's 30 pounds of anchor pulling me to the bottom. So if I ever drown, it's sad, right? But here's the one silver lining. When they pull my body up, these legs get donated to somebody else. How beautiful is that? You know? And the last thing is they have hydraulic brakes built in them so I don't go like down ramps and go bowling for people. I fly in a lot of airplanes, right? So like about 150 days out of the year, I'm on an airplane. And I don't go out and knock people over. But every now and then, to be honest, someone cuts me off and I'm like, oh, you done messed up. And I'm like, I can't stop. And like, wham, you know what I mean? And it's weird because the little kid's like usually 4 years old, you know? I know, and they're like crying. I'm like, you know what, you little punk? Like, learn some manners, you know, or whatever. And stop crying, toughen up. So that's my legs. Now, ladies and gentlemen, on the screen right now is the most important hand that I own. It's called a Greifer. That hand sits in a Crown Royal bag on the top shelf of my closet. Why is that the most important hand? I'll tell you why. That hand closes, it's like a wood clamp, down to 25 pounds of pressure. And then you close it again, and it'll go 35 pounds of pressure. And that hand sits in a Crown Royal bag because my daughter's only 10 years old. But guess what? She's gonna be 16 one day. Yeah, and her mom's gonna let her go on her first date. And that hand's coming out to party. So, no, imagine this, right? Here comes Johnny, right? He's like, hey, bro, strike one. 25 pounds of pressure. He's like, dude, that hurts. Like, I'm like, strike three, whatever. Crunch, I break Johnny's hand. And as he's crying, let me go. I don't. I pull him in closer and say, Johnny, guess what? He's like, I don't know what. No fingerprints, bro. Get out of my house. Yeah, see, you guys like that joke. When I told my daughter's first grade class when she was six and all the boys in there, the teacher was like, you can't say that. Just check. It's America. Yes, I can. So that's like the only time I ever got really sweaty. Like I was talking to all these kids, whatever. I was like, oh, I'm sorry, Mrs. Johnson. She works at the foundation now, so it's cool. We're still friends. All right, so how my hand works is off muscle flexes. I need a volunteer. We talked about this. Jump on up here with your wonderful Crocs. Get over here, you champion. All right, so you guys met this fine gentleman earlier, so I want you to make a fist, and I want you to explain how my hand works. What are you talking about? We talked about it earlier. What? This is embarrassing. All right, use that hand. Rev the engine on a moped. Okay. Rev the engine on a moped.
I don't know what a moped is.
Really? That kills my next joke I was going to make, but okay. So how it works, rev the engine on a moped. You know how it works. There it is, like that. Yeah, so see that motion? All right, so, no, put your arm, bring this, don't move it. All right, so make that flex on the moped, right? Like flex your hand up. Feel that muscle right there?
Yep.
All right, so I got that little circle in my arm. See that little hole? Point that circle out to everybody. Nope, the hole in my arm, there you go. You see, yeah. Stop it, it tickles, I'm married. So how this works is off muscle flexes in my arm. So when you flex your hand slow, like rev the engine slow on a moped. Do you know what a moped is in real life?
No.
Well, so you can't rev the engine, can you?
No.
This is not fun for me. You're killing my jokes, bro. So when I flex this muscle slow, right, when I flex that muscle slow, my hand opens. When I flex that muscle fast, flex it fast, make that twitch fast, it goes around to the left, right? And it flexes, it'll keep going until I stop. Now flex your hand up, flex your hand down. All right, feel the muscle down here. So a little circle back there. There you go, nailed it. When I flex down slow, it closes, and down fast rotates. My arm goes to about right here, where Patrick's arm is, like right there. So I got that much of my wrist left. It reads its sensor here and a sensor up here. Pretty cool technology. Now, dumbest thing ever, but you get to try it. They made my arm voice activated. You can put your hand down. Your hand did great. I'm so proud of it. So if you guys keep paying your taxes, don't worry. The government will find stupid ways to spend it. So great, good to know, right? So that my hand's supposed to be voice activated. Stupidest thing ever. Because what am I gonna do, right? Open, close, turn, and stop are the commands. So check this out, right? All right, blue lights came on, right? So now I can say open, and it'll open. I say turn, and it will turn. And then I say stop, and it will, hold on, that's embarrassing. And I say stop, and it, it's new technology, this is embarrassing. Stop. Okay. We're working on it. But say I just was mean to him at a party. And he's like, I don't know how to ride a moped. You made fun of me for not knowing how to ride a moped. And then I'm holding like just a can of soda pop, right? Just a can of soda pop. And he's like, hey, Travis, why don't you close that window? And I just crunched that can of soda pop all over myself. And he's laughing in the corner. Jerk, why'd you do that? I'm just kidding. Go ahead and try it. Give it an open. I just said it. Hang on, try to turn.
Turn.
A little bit louder.
Turn.
It's baritone soprano bass, so like less feminine, sound like a more masculine, like a man. Like sound like a man.
Turn.
Like
turn.
Think Batman, like turn.
Turn.
Like turn.
Turn.
Try close. Try close. Say close.
Close.
Like deep, like close.
Close.
Everybody wants you to get this. Like close.
You're saying this not even going.
You know what I just realized? It's not voice, that's a lie. It's not voice activated. Ladies and gentlemen, give my Vanna White a round of applause, please. Thanks, buddy. I appreciate you. You know, I usually have someone that at least knows how to rev the engine on a moped. Then I make him go vroom. I make sounds and everything. You ruined it. But anyways, no, I got Peyton Manning with that joke one time at the hospital. He came in, and you know, he's got the five head going on. He's all bobbly and whatnot. And Peyton Manning's looking at my hand. And I was like, hey, try it, Peyton. He goes, yeah, I'm going to do it. I said, all right, go for it. He goes, all right, Omaha. And I was like, oh. I was like, oh, yeah, it's your check sign. Cool, it's funny, whatever. He said, let me try it now. I'm like, yeah, Peyton, try it. He looks at me and goes, Omaha, set. I looked at Peyton Manning and said, dude, you're an idiot. The only thing Peyton Manning said to me was, your arm doesn't work right now. Oh, nationwide. Matt, you champion. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, check it out. The guy you see on stage here is the same guy you'll see at my restaurant, if you guys are hungry at the White Duck Brew Pub, or in the grocery store. I'm the same person everywhere I go. Like, this is not a facade, telling jokes and all that stuff, because I realize life's all about perspective. And on the screen right now, you'll see two guys that did not make it back home. All right, you got Frankie, who Francis Gene Phillips Worth, one by Frankie, great friend of mine. Two deployments together. Wonderful guy. On his third deployment out of Fort Bliss, Texas, his truck hit a bomb. Everybody in the truck died that day. He lost his life. His wife no longer has him. His daughter, Sophia, does not have him. I still talk to his mom. She'd give anything for one more phone call. But see, they don't get that opportunity. Brandon Goodine was 17 when he enlisted, 19 when he got killed. Left behind a 7-month-old little girl. So for these two and so many others, I keep pushing forward because I realize the price that I could have paid. I take my daughter to gymnastics. My wife and I are going on our 14th year of marriage this June. So I realize how lucky I am to still be here. On top of that, let's not forget the doctors and nurses that worked on me for 14 hours straight. They could have loosened up one tourniquet, but they kept going. With six of them that came to an event I did out in Coronado, California, four of them here on stage, they kept emailing my team, is he mad? Is he angry? Is he upset? Does Travis think this is a curse, not a blessing? And I finally, I broke down. I said, guys, thank you so much. I'm here. I took my first steps at Walter Reed while my daughter took her first steps at Walter Reed. We learned how to walk together, literally, right? Like, because they didn't give up on me. So for the medical staff in Kandahar, Bagram, Launchstuhl, Walter Reed, and everybody that went into it that supports me, I keep pushing forward. Now, I have been able to do some pretty cool things, right? I have a documentary. It's called Travis, a Soldier Story. It was on Netflix. They're getting it back on Netflix soon, I think. But it was a 2014 GI Film Festival award winner, took first place out of 55 short films. The guys that, were my medics, the guys that got hurt with me, my brother-in-law, my wife, my family, everybody's in it. So I'm pretty proud of it. Craig, all right, cool. We're going to hit this quick. Here's a trailer.
We had a call that there was an IED threat in the area. We had to go check it out and see if there was one. We went out there as normal. It was supposed to be a pretty quick mission, just a couple hours in the village right next to our strong point and back.
We were setting a gun in place. Fessy went first, swept the bank, went up and down, cleared it.
He got about 20 feet away from me. I said, okay. I took my bag off and set it down, and when I set it down,
honestly, the first thing that kicked into my mind was, this is not real. This is fake.
I remember actually while we were working on him, one of the things he said was, I just want to be able to hold my little girl again.
Do you love your daddy?
tell him I'm getting out of here in 10 months. Kept saying, why? You know, what's your big rush? I said, hey, doc, look behind you. I had pictures of me and my wife and my daughter. I have a family. Like, I live in a hospital bed. Get me out of here.
Yeah, him with Chloe, you know, she doesn't care that her dad doesn't have arms and legs. It's her dad. So it's all she knows. It's all she knows of him. So to her, nothing was lost, the way I see it.
Seeing him stand up for the first time, I could feel so much joy from him. That was like a turning point for us.
I don't understand how he does it.
I think he's meant to lead and help people. You know, he faces obstacles and he doesn't let anything stop him.
I believe God's got a plan for all of us. And after seeing Travis in action, the word bravery has more meaning to me now than it ever has.
All right, so I think it's going back to Netflix. Amazon Prime, I think, has it. It's been whatever. So if you guys want to check it out, by all means, please do. On top of that, just like Hugh had mentioned earlier, I wrote a book. When I say I wrote a book, I mean Marcus Brotherson wrote a book, and I put my name on it. It felt like high school all over again. My principal, who was the vice principal, who was my football coach, ran down to the literature teacher, Mrs. Russell, was like, you have a student with a New York Times bestselling book. And she's like, who is it? He goes, take a guess. She got to like number 30. He's like, you're never going to get it. And then she almost had a heart attack when he told her it was me. So it was crazy. No, so I wrote a book, Tough As They Come. You know, the story's going to tell itself in a lot more depth. And I'm very proud of it. But the most important part to me is actually the author's note. Because it'll tell you two things, right? Number one, it's going to tell you that my problems don't outweigh anybody else's, right? It might sound silly. I have no arms and legs standing up here. But I think collectively in this room, we probably know somebody that's going through cancer. Maybe they have some anxiety problems, some financial problems, going through a divorce. You know, and we're all in this together. So if my story can help anybody, please pass it along. I do a lot of fun videos on social media with my kids and my wife and my family and stuff like that, because I don't think that my problems are any worse than anybody else's. On top of that, it will tell you that I didn't serve any more than anybody else. So if you did serve, thank you for your service. You know, I don't put myself on the pedestal again. I did nothing more brave or heroic than anybody else. So if you were in the Army, Air Force, Coast Guard, Navy, and yes, even though I'm jealous of their uniforms, they look so good, the Marines, thank you for your service. It doesn't say it, but it should. If you're a Vietnam era veteran or have one in your family, thanks, you know, from me, tell them thanks for their service. I appreciate that. They never got the respect they deserved. And, you know, welcome home and thanks for your service. So, ladies and gentlemen, as I wrap up, I do live up my slogan of never give up, never quit. I do want everybody to know that life goes on. No matter what curveballs get thrown at you, you have to react to it, right? You have to react to it and keep pushing forward. And for me, I've been pretty blessed, right? I have my wonderful wife, and I have my daughter. And on top of that, in case you were wondering, still got it, still works, I got my son. He's 4 years old now. And I slipped that joke in there pretty good. But so my son Dax was born, right? He's a monster. He's 4 years old now. He's crazy. And I'm so fortunate to still be here and be around for them. And I think the two life lessons that I want to pass on to you that I live by are pretty simple, but I use them every day. And the two things I've learned that I want you guys to take home with you, if nothing else, is number one, don't dwell on the past. Just reminisce it. Like for me, right? I was in my hospital bed with no arms, no legs. I'd close my eyes and I would hope and I wish and I pray this never happened. And I'd close them, shut them real tight and say, how do I wake up from this nightmare? And every time I opened my eyes, I was still sitting in the hospital bed. So instead of me dwelling on what happened, not having arms and legs, getting blown up, I realized just reminisce what you had. I had 25 amazing years with arms and legs. Truly. I had one bad day at work. And then I've had going on this April 10 years that have been pretty incredible. The next thing I'll tell you guys, you can't always control your situation, but you can always control your attitude. And when I say that, like, we're still going to get angry and frustrated and upset. I get that. But for me, my situation never changes, right? Like me, I wake up in the morning in my house in Maine, and I go from my bed to my wheelchair. I get my arm off the charger, just like a cell phone charges every night. I go make my coffee, set my wife's coffee up, right? My wife, the kids, they all come out, and we go about our day. And it's all about how my attitude's going to be, because I'm in charge of that. I can't change my legs and arms being gone, but I can make sure I live as positively as possible and keep pushing forward. I'm grateful to live in the nation that we live in. I mean, I got prosthetics for days. I can drive, feed myself, walk, own a few businesses. I'd love to have you guys come out to our next open house, come to our 5K, and just let you guys know I appreciate you having me here tonight. So with that, thanks so much. Back to a, yep, turn it over to the boss lady. You guys are awesome. Thanks so much. We got a, you got the microphone in your hand.
I do.
I thought we were supposed to go up there. Are we doing that in here?
We're gonna do it right here.
Oh, okay. This got awkward quick. Sorry, guys.
We have time for a few questions, everyone. So if you have a question, just raise your hand and I'll bring this down to you.
I don't think that, yeah, you guys got any questions? I kind of answered them all, right? Like, I'm that good. Yeah. No, people are like, hey, where's your right arm at? And I'm like, it's in Afghanistan. Thanks for listening. But I do have other prosthetic hands. I mean, I'm just going to jump in. You guys didn't ask a question. I just figured some people were wondering. My body, the reason that I live in Maine right now is my wife is originally from Maine. And I'm from Michigan, and she moved to Texas when she was 11. But she wanted to go to Texas, and I wanted to go to Michigan. And we decided on Maine because I can't deal with the heat that well. So the reason I don't have my right arm on, even though you saw prosthetics, some of them, is because my body overheats really bad. So when your blood circulates to your body, your heart beats, it goes to your fingers and toes, comes back cooled down. Mine doesn't. Mine regulates faster. When you release heat from your body, it's head, hands, and feet primarily. You guys know that living in Maine, right? That's what gets cold first outside. I'm only releasing heat out of my head. That's why I'm always sweaty. I'm sorry if anybody gets a picture later. You'll feel that my back's really warm and stuff. I can't help it. And then my legs are actually covered in three layers where I have a liner, inner wall, outer wall. So if you imagine having your legs or a third of your body wrapped in wool socks and then rain gear, I got that every day. So that's why we live in Maine. Well, actually, I said Michigan. She said no. I said, let's go to Michigan. She took my arm off and started hitting me with it again. And she was like, stop hitting yourself. Stop hitting yourself. Loopholes. But that's a long way of saying it. What, Craig? What can I help you with, sir?
You said you're having a 5K for your foundation.
I have a 5K in Brunswick. Yeah, I think it's Sunday before Memorial Day in Brunswick. You guys all better go on my website and sign up. All of you. No, so we have a 5K every year, so we're having it in Brunswick this year at the flight line. Craig, why don't you just tell them? I don't run anything that I, like anything I do, guys, I'm not in charge of it, like my whole life. I'm just a talking puppet up here.
The 5K is in Brunswick at the Brunswick Naval Air Station.
Yep.
Sunday before Memorial Day.
Sunday.
And you guys should all come and see for a great cause. TravisMillsFoundation.org to get all the information for that.
Yeah. Thank you, Craig, for that question. What's up, sir? How you doing?
Thank you for your story. It's pretty incredible. Is there anything athletically you haven't been able to do that you'd like to try to achieve or accomplish?
Well, you know, I think I had to come to the understanding, like, mentally the hardest part recovery was, mentally was the hardest part of my recovery. Because I was very athletic, and I can't teach my son how to throw a spiral, right? My daughter, I tried teaching her how to play soccer when she was like four. I did okay, but now she's like the fastest kid in her school or whatever. Because I tell her if you don't win, you're walking home, and you know. And I told her, I said, I don't hang out with losers, you know. So that's what we have for breakfast conversation usually. But no, so I had to change what activities I could do for sports, right? So now instead of me teaching my daughter how to play basketball, I can go kayaking with her, you know? So like that's more of an action sport. And I think, I mean, I'd love to, if I could figure out how to get into some murder ball, which is like wheelchair rugby, I'd be all about that life. There's a really cool documentary on it. It's called Murder Ball. It sounds terrible, don't worry, it's not that bad. But like imagine like rugby, but like wheelchair rugby. It's crazy. They'd smash each other and stuff. It sounds terrible when I say it out here. But no, I think, I had to come to the understanding, like, I'm not going to be the same guy. Like, I'm not dunking the basketball anymore, you know. But I can still, you know, do downhill mountain biking or snowboarding and things like that. People wonder what my hobbies are. I actually don't have any. I work, and then I'm with my family. It's bad. Because I keep, like, I heard about this one restaurant called The White Duck. You guys ever heard of it? It's, like, so good. You should check it out. It's in East Winthrop, Maine. I just opened it, like, a month and a half ago. And if you guys don't like that place, you ever been to State Lunch down in Augusta? Place is awesome. Sean, you own that. This is my buddy Sean. He owns State Lunch, and he's great too. So go see him and then me. But no, I mean, that's for our sports goes. Like, I love sports. My kids really, you know, my son's going to do T-ball. I was like, hey, man. And then we can have, you get a baseball, like a coach to help you and my, you know, whatever for like T-ball. He's like, Dad, I can hit it to the moon already. Like, I don't care. Like, that was his response today. I'm going to hit the space into the moon. But that's a ramble. What's up?
Did you go through anything? resilient to go through something like that, or did you, and I know you were an athlete and you were successful in things, but had you had any major setbacks that kind of tested you, like anything like this at all, or did you genuinely, when you look back, are you surprised how mentally tough you were, because you, or you had experience that kind of prepared you for it?
Yeah, you know, I don't think in, like, high school and before, like, I had – I mean, we used to get killed in sports until I got to, like, junior year of high school, but I don't think that really equates to this. But I have my military training and everything, like, you know, they break you down, so, like, the military, it was rough. And then I had a couple of missions that were like, yeah, we're going on for 4 hours, and then 36 hours later, you're, like, hysterically laughing because if you don't laugh, you're going to cry type deal. And I think maybe some of those missions, like, helped me for this. It's like, well, this sucks, but, you know. And our slogan in base training was like, just play the game, you know? It was always just a game and basic. And then, you know, time goes on no matter what. And that's like the worst part. Like I found out, guys, this is the worst thing I had to find out. Like I thought I was like so awesome. And then after I got blown up, the Army didn't stop and shut down. I was like, what the? They just kept going. It was sad. But no, I think just my military training is what really probably helped me with this stuff because, you know, we had missions where it was just like terrible. I'm laughing about it. What is up, you champion with that great hair? Conrad, right?
Yeah.
Look at me knowing things.
Were you open to speaking about the high suicide rates of active duty and veterans? I believe far outweigh the number of deaths.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
And also, I mean, maybe on the larger scale and also perhaps something on the individual level, something that we could do?
Yeah. As far as like the suicide rates and all that, like that 22 a day and all that stuff, like we have the program at the foundation to help people. I've been on the receiving end of two phone calls like where people were suicidal. Like the one guy didn't admit he was suicidal and I kept trying to ask and he was like, no. I say, hey, look, man, like it's 2 a.m. My wife's in Scotland right now. Like I got my daughter to take school. If you're good, I gotta let you go. And I let him go. And then he called like two other people and then he shot himself. And he lived through it, but like you feel terrible. You're like, man, what could I have done more? But there was nothing I could have literally done more. So I just think like if people don't want to get help, it's real hard to reach out to them. So I'm trying to like make it, we're trying to make mental health more like, okay, let me tell you like my mental health journey, right? Like it's not the right one. I will never say I would did it the right way, but I would tell you if I went back in time, I'd do it the same. Mental health came in the first time I was sleeping, right? They got to talk to everybody. I was sleeping. They left. My wife told me, hey, mental health came by. I said, oh, cool. Tell them never come back here again. And she's like, what? I said, yeah, I'm not talking to them. She came in the second time. I was laying down, and my wife was like, hey, mental health's here. So I shut my eyes and pretended like I was sleeping until she left. Third time she came in, I was eating a bowl of cereal with a makeshift arm sitting up. And I was eating, I took a bite of cereal. She walked in, I might have said a curse word, I'm not going to say it tonight. And I went, oh, and I fell back in my bed and closed my eyes like I was sleeping and started fake snoring. She watched me do all this. We made eye contact, and I went, ugh. She walked over and asked me a question, and I gave her my name, rank, and my social. And she's like, what? And she asked me another question. I gave her my name, my social again. She goes, what are you doing? I said, well, if you get captured by the enemy, it's all you can tell them. So take that and leave. Or just leave. I don't care. And she's like, what? And my wife's like, you're going to make her cry. I'm like, I'm not going to make her cry. I'm just not going to tell her anything. So you're wasting your time. You can go. And that was the extent of my mental health stuff I did. Because I didn't, you know, the stigma was like, you're going to lose your guns. And you're going to get barred from doing this. Or you're going to get, you know, a label on you. So now they're trying to change that stigma, right? And it's a hard thing to change. But I think with how things are going now, people are more open to it, right? With Simone Biles being out there in front saying, hey, look, I have an issue. Like, I need to talk to somebody about it. Like, she's really huge and as a superstar in the world that needed that. So I think they're changing, you know, the perception of it. But I tell you right now, like, I didn't do it the right way. And now if a therapist is like, hey, you want to talk? I'm like, no, we're good. Like, I talked to Craig. He doesn't listen to me. And it works out great. But as far as, like, what you guys can do to help, I mean, just try and get involved. If people reach out, talk and listen and try to point in the right direction. I mean, the second guy that called that was suicidal was actually one of my best friends from high school. His house burned down, getting a divorce, and just having a rough go with everything. And, you know, I talked to him, and I let him know. You know, I said I was that more prepared than I was with the other guy. And I made him go to the hospital. He went and checked in for a week, you know, and he got help they needed, and he thanked me for it. So I think just letting people know, like, it's not a negative thing. Like, you're not going to get frowned on for doing it. And, like, that's the biggest hurdle, I think, because that's what I thought. I'm like, no one's taking my guns away. Like, I can't even shoot a gun, right? I got a bunch of them, though. I'm going to shoot them one day because I like them, but in a safe manner, what I'm saying. But That's why I get in fights with my wife about it. I show up at a gun store and then I come home with something. I'm like, I bought you another gun. She doesn't even want it. It's rude. Go there all the time. No, I'm just kidding. All right. Sorry, if that answered your question. Why don't we talk about like politics or some no, I'm just kidding. What's up? You mean like natural causes?
Or no,
like suicide if they do that?
Duty, so.
Yeah. It's a job, I guess. It's going to sound real calloused. I guess kind of it is what it is. You know, just like with me losing my arms and legs, I can't change it. It kind of is what it is. If you read my book, right, you'll see in I think I talk about it. We're on a mission, and we're so used to like getting shot at and people getting blown up and things like that. Like there's this Afghan National Police guy, and he had like one of those reflective vests on, right? Everybody had their uniform, but he had like this police reflective vest that you see like the guys working on the roads you wear. And we're like joking around, like, oh, that's the guy that's gonna get shot today. Like he's gonna get blown up, or he's definitely gonna die. And we're like joking around about it because it was just like normal to talk about. Well, unfortunately, that was the guy that got killed that day. He got targeted and shot, and I was like, no way. And then it's just like, you go on, you know, just to the next thing. And, it's rough, but at the same time, like, it's kind of part, everybody knows going in, you know, it's drilled into you. Like, I mean, we get ready for, like, in basic training, you get ready to go to dinner or go to lunch or whatever, and you got to do, it's like, prepare for child formation, and then you, like, they yell that, and then you say, one shot, one kill, kill we will, right? It's kind of brainwashing in a way, but you just deal with it, I guess. I don't know. I don't have any good answers here for you guys tonight. Like, I don't dig deep into my psyche at all. Like, I'm like, what? There's sports on? College football? I'm in. March Madness? All about it. Craig, you want to get some wings later? I'm super hungry. That's all I think about. Sorry, I'm not good at this. I am a doctor, though. I got three of them. Three doctorates. They're honorary. I showed up to Unity College for a dinner, and then I went the next day and they gave me a doctorate. Bates College, I went just for, like, 2 hours. They gave me one. I haven't got one from Colby yet. My business partner, his wife's actual real dentist, and she has her own practice. And she's like, "Oh, Travis, those are you know, honorary." I said, "What? I got three. I'm sorry. Catch up. Pump them arms. You know what I'm saying?" And she gets mad. Whatever. All right, guys. Anybody else? I know it's getting late on school night for you guys. You just little whippersnappers. I'm an adult. I'll stay up till 1 o'clock if I want. I won't. I'll be in bed by like 9. I'm old. All right, is that it? Yeah, you guys are awesome. Thanks so much for your time. Appreciate it. Adrian, back to you. Thanks, guys. Floor is yours, Patrick.
Black Pontiac with a pocket of cash, foot on the gas. Ready and throwing up a little dust like a pickup truck does in the mud, but ain't nobody slowing us down right now. She said, I need a little something with some get up and go, and nobody knows how to get me going quite like you do when you're doing the things that you do. Want to get this sleepy boy from town something to talk. Some time, let the heat cool off. We could do it some dancing. Didn't take long, just a couple of songs. You know it's last call when the law comes walking in. So we will tell lights fading from some blue lights chasing. Cut a path through the car off County Road 44. Tore up a fence, jumping a ditch. Felt so good, didn't want to end. So we pocket of cash, foot on the gas, ready and throwing up a little dust like a pickup truck does in the mud, but ain't nobody slowing us down. Friday night you text me, dead asleep, baby come get me, right or left tonight was at your house, one dirt road down, second we pulled out that driveway.